First time in the history of Olympics, India won a medal, and that too a gold in track and field events. Only second Indian to win an individual gold in Olympics. 87.58 meters. Yes, this shall be etched in the history as a landmark measurement. The throw distance that won Subedar Neeraj Chopra or for Rajref a gold medal. On that high note, I, Siddharth Dave, welcome you all in yet another edition of Hindu Genius monthly webinar. Just a short description about Hindu Genius. Hindu Genius Group has been formed with a view to bring together like-minded people who are interested in taking our country forward. Welfare of the country is our prime concern. Group holds meeting once in a month, that is on the first Saturday of each month. Two speakers talk on matters of national interest for a duration of 20 odd minutes each, followed by Q&A session. So we begin today's webinar with a Saraswati Vandana rendition by Usha Pathakji from Nasik. Usha Pathakji, please.
Can I just add one thing? Siddharthji, can I add just one thing?
Yeah, please.
We have Petkar who won Olympics gold medal in the 60s. Because in shooting, we also had Tangelo in Rio de Janeiro for high jump. We should not miss out just because they were para Olympics.
Yes, Raviji, I just read a scripted one, and what I said was first time in the history of Olympics, India won a medal and that too a gold in track and field events. So this was the first that gold the, ever in a track and fields event. For Olympics in
high jump is also track and field, no?
Jump
is also sure. So Tangavelu won last time. We should be talking of all the whether Paralympics also is fought by all countries in the world. Uh-huh. So where it is advantageous to us, we should include them first. Anyway, carry on. Usha ji, aap continue.
Namaste. Aaj main aapke saamne Sharada Vandan, Saraswati Vandana. सादर कर रही हूँ। हे शारदे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ। हे शारदे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ। तू स्वर्ग की जननी जिसे हर शब्द तेरा हर गीत तुझसे तू स्वर्ग की देवी ये संगीत जिसे हर शब्द तेरा है हर गीत तुझसे हम हैं अकेले हम हैं अधूरे हम हैं दूरे हे शरण में हमें प्यार दे माँ हे शारदे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ मुनियों ने समझी जानी वेदों की भाषा पुराणों पानी गुणियों ने समझी गुणियों ने जानी वेदों की भाषा पुराणों पानी हम भी तो समझे हम भी तो जाने हम भी समझे तो जाने विद्या का हमको अधिकार दे माँ हे शारदे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें पार दे माँ तू श्वेत वर्णी कमल पे विराजे हाथों में वीणा मुकुट सर पे साजे तू श्वेत वर्णी कमल पे विराजे हाथों साजे उनसे हमारे मिटा कर अंधेरे मन से हमारे मिटा कर अंधेरे हमको उजालों का संसार देना हमको उजालों का संसार देना हे शारदे माँ हे शारदे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ हे शारदे माँ हे शारदे माँ हे शारदे माँ शारदे माँ। धन्यवाद
धन्यवाद उषा पाठक जी। With this invocation of Ma Saraswati, we begin our program. And first in sequence, we have Thirukkural by Kamalayani from Chennai.
Namaste to all. Is it audible?
Yes, I can hear you.
Kural, Eidar Kariyad Yeinda Kal Annilaye. செய்தற்கரிய செயல் விளக்கம் கிடைத்தற்கரிய காலம் வந்து வாய்க்குமானால் அந்த வாய்ப்பை பயன்படுத்தி கொண்டு அப்பொழுதே செய்தற்கரிய செயல்களை செய்ய வேண்டும். எக்ஸ்பிளனேஷன் இன் இங்கிலீஷ். இஃப் எ ரேர் ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டி அக்யூர் வைல் இட் இஸ் லாஸ்ட் லெட் அ மேன் டூ தட் விச் இஸ் ரேர்லி டு பி அக்கம்ப்ளிஷ்ட். ஜெய்ஹிந்த். தேங்க்யூ டு ஆல்.
Thank you, Anandri. And
Siddharthji, one minute. May I interrupt? Just, I want to add one small sentence about Kamalayani. She's a college student and she is a fisherman's daughter, but she is an aspiring journalist. And she is a gold medalist. Coming, although from a very poor background, she is a gold medalist and exemplary in her studies. So this is just for information.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So after Thirukkural, we have a corresponding Kabir Doha by Priyanka Shenoy ji, a young student from Singapore. Priyanka Shenoy ji.
Namaste. Am I audible?
Yes, ji. Yes, ji. Okay. Yes, yes, Priyanka ji.
Sant Kabir ke dohe, jata hai so jaan de, teri dasa na jai. केवटिया की नाम न्यू गन्ने मिलेंगी आई भाव अर्थ जो जाता है उसे जाने दो तुम अपनी स्थिति को दशा को ना जाने दो यदि तुम अपने स्वरूप में बनी रहे तो केवट की नाव की तरह अनेक व्यक्ति आकर तुमसे मिलेंगे मीनिंग लेट पीपल कम एंड गो एंड डोंट गेट अफेक्टेड बाय द पीपल अराउंड यू जस्ट लाइक अ बोट्समैन हु कंटिन्यूज हिज जॉब यू टू विल मीट मेनी पीपल थैंक यू.
Thank you, Priyanka ji. With this, we move on to the main section for today's webinar. And the first speaker that we have is K.K. Moradian ji. I'll share a brief introduction about K.K. Moradian ji. K.K. Moradian ji's background spans three continents. He has worked with multinational companies in India, in Hoya, Roque, Alstom, Tata Group. In France, with Univerve, Alstom, and in United States of America with the Parsons Group. His experience spans countless industries, including engineering, power, transport, infrastructure, consumer goods, IT, and agriculture, with experience ranging from CFO to strategic consultant to managing director. He holds postgraduate degrees from Bombay University, Jamnalal Bajaj Institute, and Thunderbird, a certificate from INSEAD, and a bachelor's degree in engineering from Bombay University. K.K. Moradian ji has helped numerous companies do business successfully in India and has enabled several Indian companies to expand abroad. As an interim manager, he excels in restructuring and turning around companies, especially those on the verge of bankruptcy. He is known to take swift actions to build a team of high-performing individuals with impeccable integrity. He is experienced in setting up effective organizational structures with efficient SOPs and systems, in quickly offshoring non-core businesses, and in rewarding creativity. As interim manager, Muradianji has implemented over 17 mergers and acquisitions and disinvestments. And he has also set up 2 greenfield sites. KK Muradianji also specializes in guiding companies to speedily align local operations with the parent company's organizations, policies, and procedures. He has a proven track record of dealing with graft and ensuring that operations are conducted with the highest ethical standards. He is a strong believer in succession planning, which is the best way for companies to create an internal talent pool, which can in turn assist them in growth and acquisitions or expansions. The topic for today is investment and business opportunities in European countries. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome KK Muradianji.
Thank you, Siddharth, for his kind words. Let me start by saying that there are a lot of large companies in India from France. France is a very big investor in France, from in India. And there are French companies like old Alstom, which is now GEC, Rocket, Capgemini, Saint-Gobain, Dassault. But a lot of these companies also get work done for Europe in India. We had set up a back office services for designing switchyard for worldwide requirement, which used to be done in France, but which is now done in India. So like that, there are a lot of examples where one should keep in mind that there are large multinationals who also do exports for India, number one. Number two, the same thing applies for Indian companies who are already present in India, but do a lot of work in India, but they have their presence in Europe. And these are Larsen & Toubro, Tata Consulting Services, Aegis, Quest Global, you know, and then there are pharma companies. So there are already companies in India, and I mean India and France, doing a lot of trade, but these are mostly large companies. So my presentation is not meant for people from these companies or large companies who have their own manpower, who have their own knowledge base to do business. My presentation and my talk will be mostly focused for small and medium Indian businesses who can take the opportunity of doing business in Europe. So I will start with my presentation. Just give me a minute to come in. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay. So I just want to show you. Okay. First, let's look at the macro level, what is going on. And as you can see, the GDP of India is $3 trillion US dollars. These are, I should have written that US dollars. And European Union is 15. So they are almost five times our size. The population of European Union is 450 compared to 1.4 billion in India. European Union as a group exports 2.4 billion, while we are only at 330 billion just now. Exports is 2.4 trillion by European Union, and imports is 1.8 trillion, while in our case, import is 500 billion. But this exports and import figures, which you see for EU, if you add within the European Union the trade that is going on, the percentage is huge. It's amazing. Like most countries, even China and India, we do like 20% exports. But if you look at the within European Union, Germany and France and Italy and Spain and all, they are doing 30-40% of the business within the European Union. So it is, it's become a very European Union. The way I look at it, it's like India in many ways. India is one country, but we are very diverse. We have, you know, 22 languages, 2,000 dialects. We have, you know, all kinds of communities, so many different people from different levels of society, so many gods. European Union is almost like India. You have people from different languages spoken. They are different, totally different people, like North Indians and South Indians and Indians and Bengalis. You'll find the same thing you'll find with the French and the Spanish and all. So they are not one people. But thanks to European Union, which has been formed, they are almost, I see a parallel with India. Only thing different is that they also have their own currency, which is unified now. And like in India, there used to be border trade wars between the countries, which is not there anymore. So which has been removed in India. India used to have all these border controls and all between states for different duties and different taxes and all that. So in many ways, European Union, you should look at a different India. Then now if you look at the at a macro level again, the labor. Their labor is only 5% for agriculture, producing 5% of GDP. While in India, we have 41% labor in agro versus only 16% of the GDP. So when the government of India says that our agro sector finally, I mean, the level of income would reach double, triple, whatever, it may be a figure which has been thrown, but reality is at some point of time, Indian labor, Indian agro situation will also change, which means there'll be different opportunities. And we have turned about this topic before, where it will only come about with value additions. Like, for example, Rocket, a French company which acquired Rocket Redisiti in India. We used to make starch from corn, but then with modification and with the factories set up, we could make so many products from starch. Then if you look at industry, 22% labor and 24% GDP is proportion. Service, 73%, 71%. So you see the labor and the GDP are in same proportions, while in India, it's very disproportionate. Service industry, which is generating half of our GDP, only 33% has this. The reason I'm showing you this is because just to see, ultimately, we are also going to change. I remember when I was growing up in 60s and 70s, the agro sector used to be 70-75% labor. Now it is 41%. It will continue to fall because as industrialization takes place and as progress happens, doesn't mean that agro is going to disappear. The labor level of what work they do will improve. Then I have a third slide, which the next slide is European Union exports to different countries and imports from different countries. The size, as you know, before it is 2.4 billion and 1.8 billion for imports. But USA is 18%, imports is 12%, China is 10%. Look at the amount of exports China does, this 22 figure. Amazing what China has done. Not necessarily by fair practices. And I had the same problem. I had a problem when I was running Alstom in India. I found that China was dumping goods at below material cost. And being a private industry, there was no support. And it's very sad because at that time, we had approached the previous government to put some duties on Chinese goods, but the government was not interested. And ultimately, so many factories have in India, good manufacturing factories shut down because of imports from China. But I'm glad that finally we have woken up and we are taking action. But when I show you this is the figure which ultimately we have to target, because more and more Chinese, European Union, after what happened with COVID, they, especially the ones who were totally dependent on European, I mean, totally dependent on China for getting the raw material of some finished goods or semi-finished goods. Now they want to offset the risk by looking for somewhere else. For example, even mask, 90% of the mask came from China for the world requirements. This is so ridiculous. And mainly because the three-ply mask, the inner lining of the mask is made out of a plastic material, which is nobody makes it in the world because it is very polluting. And because of ridiculous environmental standards, everybody stopped manufacturing all over the world except China. So now there is a wake-up call. Anyway, so if you look at the UK, 14% exports, 10% import. But look at India, 1.7, 1.9. It is, we are so small, we are just a fraction. But we should not be sad looking at this figure because it clearly shows what is opportunity. I mean, even if we double our output, we are still nowhere here. So there is a potential just looking at this figure of what we can do. But now when you look at our country as a whole, we are exporting to United States 17 and importing only 7. But again, China, even India, look at how disproportionate it is. I looked at the first two quarter of this year figures. Can you hear me?
Sorry.
Hello? Can you hear me, everybody?
Yes, I can hear.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. And now with EU also, we are exporting 15% and importing only 9%, but that will change now because of the government of India rightly building up defense, which is, we are way behind. We used to be way behind in our defense, especially Air Force. And with the Dassault import and all, there will be a big change in these figures. But again, there is a big potential here. So my main point is here, 1.7% exports and 1.9% when you take European Union as a whole and look at where China is. China used to be behind India in the 60s, and this is where they are now. So we have potential for taking over a good part of the market. Now, what is the imports which comes from European Union worldwide is... surprise, electronic equipment, electrical equipments. Again, these are mostly from China. Minerals, some of it comes from India. Fuel from Middle East. Oil, machinery, tech, vehicles, pharmaceuticals. Pharmaceutical includes the masks, which I told you. And rest 50% is where a good part of Indian export comes, is appliances, textiles, some chemical, precious stones is a big business for India. But one thing also keep in mind, I would like to go back to this slide where you are seeing this, you see the United Arab Emirates figures, a lot of the Indian export which goes to United Arab, ultimately it is going to different countries. So it is a misleading because of the tax rate, no tax regime in UAE, a lot of India's export is channelized through UAE. So it kind of distorts the figure. So now what comes from India so far, which what the figure of 1.9 million figure, which you see, a good part of it, as I said earlier, jewelry, textiles, diamonds. What is encouraging is that when people don't know about it, there is a company called Aegis, which makes components for Boeing and Dassault, which is made there in Belgium. Based in Belgium Industrial Park, they have their own industrial park, and they make components, all 100% exports, again bought by. So there are, Larsen & Toubro does quite a few exports in manufacturing. So there is a scope, tremendous scope of even exporting manufactured goods. Textile, it is very sad that we have lost some part of the market share because of bad labor policy to Bangladesh. But in a way it is good. Bangladesh is a friendly country. The if you have a prosperous neighbor, you have less problem to deal with, unlike in Pakistan. So anyway, so there are areas of textile diamond is got flat, but the area where we can grow substantially is by supplying components of manufacturing products, like for aircraft parts, already automobile parts also we are exporting from India a lot. Now, just to let you know that it is not like United States or UK. When you come to European Union, it is a very complicated place to work, because it's not one country. And you have, unlike in India, where if you know English, you can still manage to do business. In European Union, in France, you must know French. In Germany, you must know German. In Italy, you must know Italian. It makes it very difficult. It's a packing rules. Each country, when you pack, when you send packaged goods, it has to have their language written on it. The customs duties are different. Not much different. Most of the duties are the same, but there are some exceptional products for which import duties, while uniform, there may be some custom requirements which are different. Like, for example, mask in the past, you could not import mask in France, but you could import it in Germany. So you have to again see what is the product. Opening a simple thing like a bank account is not easy, because they have strict regulations. They want to know your business plan. They want to know who are the people involved. They are very, very particular about laundering of money. So they do they own their own check on the people involved in opening the account, who are the people in the company. So that is number one. So you have to keep this in mind. Standardization. There's a lot of standardization, as I said earlier, especially on import duty for tests required. Previously, there used to be every country would have their own requirement for product before being sold. You have to get it tested or get regulation approval. Like, for example, in India, you have FSSAI. Like that, they had a similar one for every country, but now it is standardized. So general European Union, there is a central agency which will do the tests. Of course, you have to use the help of testing agencies like Bureau Veritas, Cotecna, Eurofina, etc., which are specially approved, which are ISO approved. So to open a business, one good thing is there is standardization for product approvals. But if you want to come here and start your own, you require a simple residency permit. Now, this is where it gets a little complicated, because each of the EU country has its own. While you're in one of the countries, you can then travel to any of the countries and sell to any of the countries. But to operate in a country, the requirement for banking and the requirement for setting up a company is a little bit complicated. Then you come to, I'm just giving an example, like for France, you have, just like in India, when you set up a company, you have publicly limited, you have private limited, your partnerships, all deemed partnership, etc. There are maybe 5, 6, or 7. In France, there are like 33 different classifications. You have SA, where you have to have minimum 2 people, then SARL, which is my company, you have to have minimum person up to 100. Then if it is only 1%, it is EURL. Then you have SAS, where no capital required, but then if you are gonna, manufacture something, then it is SAS, but then you have to specify specifically what is the thing you're selling. There are, depending on whether you plan to declare dividend, whether you want to borrow money from different companies, again, there are different. So setting up a corporate structure, one has to be very careful how you do it. Then I put down key points to keep in mind when you start. Best thing is, because of these language issues as well as regulations, if somebody wants to start a small business for import or export or whatever, and especially when it comes to business to consumer, like what I mean is by retail, it is better to have a local partner and also to try and sell to big companies which have the benefit of branding. Now, the benefit of branding, it is amazing what it does. And I'll give you my example of Alstom, even in India itself. I had a strike situation. My market share was 25% of making small motors, just small ordinary motors. And Suguna is a Coimbatore-based company, which had a market share of 4%. Now, when I had problems in my Calcutta factory and they went on strike, all I did was source my motors from Suguna and I just put my logo Alstom on it. Just all I did was just hammer my logo on Alstom, of Alstom on the motor, and I was selling the same product at 30% higher price than Suguna. It is unbelievable. People would buy only Alstom motor, even if some of them knew that it is coming from Suguna, mainly because of the image, mainly because of the branding, mainly because they knew that if something goes wrong, Alstom will honor it. They will fix the problems. Of course, we had a very good after-sales service and the motors would never fail anyway. But we gave all kinds of assurances and guarantees. So that is the power of having an associate. So if you, as far as we are concerned, we want to sell our product. If we had to do branding, it will cost us 100% more money. So it is better to use some of these partners who have branded products. Like, for example, Zara. Zara is a $26 billion company just selling clothes. And 100% of the product comes from abroad. They don't make any of them. And they're still $26 billion, all because of the branding. So what you can do is initially, if you have financial constraints to expand or grow or something, if you're a small player, better to find a local partner. And some of these partners may buy from Europe, but they may be again in turn exporting to other countries. For example, I know that in Germany, there is a company which is, you know, has got a contract for Qatar. You know, Qatar is having this, what is that race? Coming up in 2022, there is a big race for which they're even advertising. Already, the German company is exporting organic food, and most of it, a lot of it is being sourced from India. So they source from India and sell because they have the network of connections everywhere in the world. So that is the advantage of having local partners. Then one should remember that if you show that your product meets all the tests, that you can get the certification. Certification, getting a certification is an expensive proposition depending on what the product is. It can vary from 3,000 euros to even 50,000 euros. What is important is to show your references. If you already have supplied to some foreign companies, well-known companies, a reference definitely helps. And then one should keep in mind that with large companies, if you want to be a vendor, they have their own vendor due diligence where they again look at your certification. They may even send somebody at your factory to see the location where it is. They want to see the hygiene. They want to see the safety standards. European Union rules for safety standards and hygiene standards are very strict. So they send their own people because they don't want to spoil their image. If something goes wrong with one of the vendor factories, it gives a bad image to people buying the product from those factories. So the Europeans like to make sure that the condition of working is good, as well as there are safety standards implemented in the local manufacturing. I mean, if you see, when I was running Alstom in India, I mean, we had safety requirements very, we had to meet the European safety requirements, even though we were, of course, satisfying the Indian condition. By far, the European Union requirements were much more stringent, but we had to modify our manufacturing processes, setups, fire protection, everything, you know, workers, distance between the machines, distance between the workers working together, everything was very strictly regulated. Then there are all these countries also have the business councils in India. They are quite good, even though there may be some people who may not, they are mostly because they don't, excuse me, because a lot of the people working in these business councils are there for 3-year durations. So they keep changing each time and a lot of new people come in. But you can get some lot of preliminary data from these people. Then transparency. One thing, please, we Indians are very good at giving promises, which we unfortunately sometimes cannot keep. The Europeans don't mind if for some reason there is a delay in meeting the requirements, as long as you tell them up front. We don't have to say, all right, it's coming. Excuse me, I have a little cough problem, 1 minute. So please, before committing anything, make sure you have the capacity, you have the sourcing in place, your raw material supply chain is in place, you have timed the things properly. Don't promise what you cannot deliver. The other thing you should keep in mind, and this is very important, it's a very, very good thing about the Europeans. They do not always, they prefer not to go to number one or number two from India or anywhere else in the world. They like to encourage small businesses. They like to encourage new players. They like to encourage entrepreneurs. So if you don't be hesitant just because you're not a big player and you're approaching a big multinational, multi-billion dollar operations, don't worry. If you are honest, if you tell them this is what you're doing, this is your qualification, and you show your factory, as long as you deliver quality products on time, they will support you even if you're small. That is very, very important. What is important, the other thing you must know about the Europeans as compared to Americans, if you have established a relationship and let's say you're selling something for $100, let's say, somebody else, after you establish a relationship, somebody else comes and says, hey, I can supply to you for 95. It is very unusual. The European Union will come back to you and say, hey, this guy is supplying me for 95, so you cut your price. It will not happen. What the Europeans do, they take the long time to make sure they have done the vendor due diligence. They have established relationship with you. They have checked your quality. They have checked your delivery thing. They have checked your factory. They are giving you a price which they think is fair. They will not just dump you because somebody else told them that they can supply for less price. One thing is there, when you make a presentation, please make nice presentation. It has to be very professional. I see sometimes the presentations coming from India are really terrible. You know, our websites sometimes are not good. It is very important to color combinations which we use, or the wordings that we use, or the pictures that we put on our presentations are very well done. The other thing is, while we Indians have a tendency, we can be very friendly very quickly. In Europe, it is not the case. They like to keep that distance with the co-workers, etc. The other thing is, we should be very sensitive to cross-cultural issues. Again, it varies from country to country. One thing I noticed that the French and Italians and the Spanish, or basically the Latin people, they love Indian culture, they love Indian clothes, Indian dresses. But when you come here, you should do, you know, as the saying goes, when in Rome, do what the Romans do. When you dress up, or when your eating habits, using the fork and a spoon, etc., and the way you greet. And I will give you an example of, I think I'm not hesitant to give out the name, Vijay Malviya had come for an acquiring of a winery. It was a $330 million acquisition. This company was for sale. It was a some 350-year-old family business for sale. So, you know, you're talking of very, very, when you have companies which are that old, that means they have this family tradition, they have the family style. So I was there helping them from the their side about Indian operations. And when Vijay Malia was the only buyer who gave a price, and he met the price, for 2 years they were not able to sell. And it was when he walked into the boardroom, you know, the boardroom of this European Union manages $300 million. The whole family was present. They were all well dressed. They were all with spick and span suit and shoes, etc. And here walks in Vijay Malia with a hairy chest, no suit, jeans. You could with golden chains hanging around his neck, hair not combed. The moment he walked in and I saw him, I knew that this deal will not happen. And as soon as he left, the deal was off the table for him. And he could not understand why they could not sell, would not sell the company to him when he's the only guy offering the price which was wanted. He was not even asking for a discount. For them, they were selling a company which was reputed, which has a brand image, and they did not want that image to be spoiled by somebody like Vijay Malviya buying it just because he had at that time the money. Okay, priorities, as I've said before, it is very important that you don't compromise on quality and delivery, and also important consistency. We must make sure that the product is of the same quality every time. And as I said earlier, transparency, any problem, any issues, please let them know first. And last thing you must keep in mind, most important thing, never ever talk about price first, because price is not that an important an issue when you deal with European Union in general. They like to know their reliability is very important, relationship is important, trust is important. And then, of course, price, of course, they will negotiate with you. But once they negotiate, they're not going to haggle. What is important for them is the quality, delivery, consistency, more than the price. And as I told you earlier, the partner, you're a strong partner after relationship is established. It may take longer to establish the relationship, but once you establish, it is really long term. They will not change you unless you screw up the deal. Huh? And of course, Raviji, this is for your eyes, but I think at this point, when you saw the figures and for us to grow, and I know that a lot of changes are happening in India from the government of India, what it has to do. And as I said, some of these are already in process, but a lot more needs to be done and done fast. We have to encourage local entrepreneurship. We should have economic zones with improved infrastructure, just showing the land and saying that, oh, I'm giving you this land for cheap. That is not what is required. What is required is a complete infrastructure, power connection, water supply, sewage disposal, everything. Quick clearances are required. We should give tax breaks. For example, now, a manufacturer, for example, in the United States, he's buying fuel for his operation or welding machine for his operation at cheaper rate, almost half the cost or one third the cost of India. How can we compete? Just because our labor is cheap doesn't mean we can compete. We have to make sure that the complete indirect tax structure is modified and there are some incentives given and reduce bureaucracy, which has improved. Clearances are compared to when I first started business in 1975 with Tata Consulting. So in engineers, till now, a lot of improvements has happened, but then we have to compare with not what we have already done. We have to compare with what we have to do to meet competition. If you want to exit, if you want to cross China, there is a lot more to be done. The labor laws also have to be modified. Okay. And then China factor, I've already covered part of it, that they are looking for backup supplies. So already people who are 100% dependent on China are looking out. Unfortunately, a lot of them are looking at Vietnam and Indonesia and Philippines. I think we need to, government needs to help in small businesses and actively, some of these things could be government to government, but if not, even with the steps which I told you, if we take, we could be an alternative supplier. Some of this information can be obtained by going to the embassy and talking to the local business councils. China, you can't deny that they have been quick. You still get good material delivery consistency, because in their case, if they supply at a cheaper price, anything, the government would subsidize it or make it up for it. But then I think another point which I mentioned, please keep your references ready. Last, another point is that you must have patience. Dealing with European Union is not like dealing with Middle East or Americans. They take their time because, as I said, they do a lot of internal due diligence. But once, as I said, once you have made an entry, long term, nothing like it to be with them. And just this point which I put down, low quality versus large quantity, low quantity. To give an example about shoes, if you see the Nike and Adidas shoes which are used in sports, mostly it comes from China. But if you see the dress shoes which are normally Nike and Adidas and all, the order books are, each batch size is more than 100,000, sometimes even a million numbers. But when it comes to India, when it comes to Europe, they all wear different dress shoes, which are made in mostly factories in and around Chennai, because those are small batch size, like 10,000 quantity. The French want quality. And I must tell you, I was involved with one of the companies in India, sourcing from India for some of the uppers, what they call for shoes. And I found that the Europeans depended on India for supply of low quantity, but high good quality shoes. China, of course, they have a fantastic infrastructure. India's export. I think Gadkari has done a good job with highway systems. We still need improvements in the power connections for the factories, sewage disposal, water supply. Because if you have to compete aggressively and reach a large size, we are three trillion, and if we want to reach not just 5 trillion, but 10, 20 trillion, we need all these things, infrastructure in place. And then we'll also try to find out local manufacturers or foreign companies which export to, which use India for the base, like Capgemini does for IT. Capgemini, by the way, is adding 14,000 employees every year in India alone. They have become totally Indian company, although it's a French company. Same thing, Sagoma. What is interesting is that worldwide they are losing money. In India, they are making money. I ran Alstom in India, we were the only ones making money. The rest of the world, they were losing money. So India can be a serious base for manufacturing also. And as I mentioned earlier, get your test and certification done. Thank you. And I'll take question answer. I don't know, up to you, Siddharth. You
yes, to... yes, 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 yes. Thank you so much. It's just an appeal to all participants and audience. Please share your questions and comments in the chat box. At the end of both the presentations and speeches, we'll have a Q&A round. Where Ashaji would be coordinating your question and answers. Thank you. Thank you so much, Khodadadji, for that exhilarating sequence of suggestions. And I would say almost like a management classroom for all of us here. And that goes on to show how investment and business opportunities in European countries could be garnered, especially by the Indian companies. And thank you so much once again for a wonderful presentation. Next, we have Shri Subrat Kumar Prashti ji. Before you speak, Shubhrat Kumar Prashtiji, may I give a short introduction about you, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Dhanyavaad. Shri Shubhrat Kumar Prashtiji belongs to 1996 batch of Indian Telecommunication Services. Bhaina is presently working as Director of Technology in Department of Telecommunications. He has also worked in Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, TRAI, as Joint Advisor. He considers himself to be a thinker, and he broadcasts his thoughts as slides under the banner Open Total Development Forum. His more than 8,000 tweets can be seen in his Twitter ID, Subrat365. He has conceptualized the Sanskrit operating system for Indian languages called SOIL for uniting all Indian languages through new code called Sanskriti. He has organized the TEDx Bhubaneswar in the year 2010 and led the Indian delegation to ITU Telecom World Budapest, where he has emphasized the Vedic knowledge for global peace and connectivity. Bhaina has delivered talks in various universities and colleges on the role of ICT for total development of local areas by a short name TODOLA in education and other sectors. He has keen interest in development of Indian cultural heritage. He is also a very prominent Odia poet and writes Odia poems. Today's topic is growth of India's culture and economy through temples. Bhaina, over to you.
नमस्कार धन्यवाद इज इट ऑडियो विजिबल नाउ
यस यस भाई आज्ञा
माय टॉपिक इज ग्रोथ ऑफ इंडियाज कल्चर एंड इकोनॉमी थ्रू टेम्पल्स I will go first to my favorite temple, that is Konark Temple in Bhubaneswar. As you go to Konark Temple, you will see there are animals statues on the bottom. It is like for the children. It is for the age group of less than 5. You can have also the musicians in music. We also have the dance, trade, astrology, science. So we can consider our temple walls as visual encyclopedia. So what is a temple? What is a temple for a local people? What is a temple for an outside tourist? What is a temple for brahmacharya, for child and young, for gaharastya, for married couples, vanaprastha, for family? And sannyasa for knowledge seekers. So my slides will have lot of pictures. This is the second slide. So brahmacharya, gaharstya, vanaprastha and sannyasa and the Hindu temples for these four periods of life. Brahmacharya is learning in a playful manner all the inputs required for development to healthy, wealthy, protected and blissful life. The next is Gaharstya, to have a family, enjoying the worldly pleasures with wife and children and family. The Vanaprastha, the third stage, thinking and acting for the community, giving more importance to development of the system, being deeply involved with it. Then Sannyasa, that is the fourth stage, preparation to leave this earth blissfully, to donate to others, may it be family or the community. But remember, all these four parts, Brahmacharya, Gaharstya, Vanaprastha, Sannyasa, they have different roles, different purposes, different types of developments. They are related to different Purusartha. For example, Brahmacharya is not related to Kama. It is related to Artha and Dhana. Gaharstya and Vanaprastha, they are related to Dharma, Artha and Kama, but not Moksha. Sannyasa is for Dharma and Moksha. They may forgo Artha and Kama. And there are different types of developments. So we have to understand the life to understand the temples. Sri Krishna, Sri Rama, then Shiva, Parvati. So there are different types of development. self development, knowledge development, workplace development, system development, community development, family development, and then there are different types of goals. For example, a child should do meditation, yoga, study, work plan, but the Aharsya may do something else because his objective is different than Brahmacharya. Similarly, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa has different objectives. So when we see the temples, we have to see the temples from respective point of view. We should match the goal and the age of the person. If we don't match like that, then we are actually confused. Then after going through the temples, we must be interested how to go to the temples. India has more than 1 million temples. Can we map, connect and make the facilities available for online booking in those temples? How will we go there? Can we go by walk, a horse or a car, bus, taxi, group, train, plane? Or if it is an island, can I go by boat or ship? Where will stay there? Hotels, rooms, halls, guest houses, mess, down for tent? What will do there? What can be done there? We'll do the worship, taking part in numerous festivals, trekking, swimming. What we'll know there? We can know the science and history over centuries, culture, art, with scriptures. All these are part of the activities of economy and culture. But are we organized? Are we connected? Even like our Jainatirtha, who have a very good website where all these things are available. We have millions of temples, but still we are not connected in a structured and a dedicated manner. Let us come to the first place. Why we go to a temple? We have a very tasty, healthy and good food. Temples make the ecosystem to eat healthy and stay healthy. They have innovative and eco-friendly ways of preparing the healthy foods. In Jagannath Mandir, the foods are prepared in earthen pots and serving them in banana leaves. So the collection of all these locally available raw materials nearby the temples for preparation of varieties of food is a part of the economic activity. And science and technology of food preparation, different types of foods, tastes, and their effect on the body, which food should be taken at what time of the day, in which season, raw materials required to prepare different types of foods, knowledge and skills to prepare foods from raw materials can be considered the greatest economic input. Then the next is dances. As you know, in India, there are a lot of dances, classical dances. Each temple was a center of classical dance, music, devotional, bhajans. And temples are also the preserver of art, painting, dance, songs, music, and jatra. Our Lord Shiva is the Nataraj. It means he's the king of dance, songs, and music. So if you see, he is not only Nataraj, he is also Maheshwar. And he is worshipped in thousands and thousands of temples across India. And temples, not only for worships, they are also for sanskars, for learning about Veda, Vedanga. Temples are for shelter in disaster areas. Temples are massive structures made in stone, protecting the people in the time of disasters. Temples have also mathas, ashramas, anathashramas attached to it. Starting from the total development from childhood, there are 16 sanskaras which are deeply associated with temples. Bhagavata Parayana is done in temples. People know about Hindu scriptures, Veda, Upanishad, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavata, through Prabhachana, Pala, Daskatya in Odisha. Ramlila is celebrated involving people of all ages. And most important is that temples also maintain generational database of the people, local people, keeping the information chronologically. We have Madala Panji in Puri, where Jagannath Mandir keeps the data of all the Mandir history for thousands and thousands of years. Next is Ayurveda, as you know, is the science of life. Based on Ayurveda, there are different plants which are used in worshipping the deities in temples. So if you go to a Vishnu temple, they will give you a Tulasi Patta. If you go to a Shiva Mandir, they will give you Belapatta. So Tulasi Patta, Belapatta and Prasads make people healthy. The Homa in the temple purifies the village atmosphere. Prasad of the temple is considered of the best quality. So temples detoxify the environment, purify the ecosystem. There are gosalas attached to the temples. We have Gorakhani temples are also considered the monument for cows. And not only that, if you can see the temples, they are full of science, engineering, innovation to learn from. And not only temples, only for the people who are living in cities or villages, it is also people who are living in forests. We have Banadevi, Banadurga, Devaraya, the temple for the goddess of the forest. Different parts of India, there are different temples of gods and goddesses of forest. You are Devaraya in Maharashtra, the groves are often a rich source of rare fruits and plants. We have Sri Vana, Tapovana, Panchavati, Naimisharanya, Dandakaranya. All these types of forests have a typical characteristic. For example, Sri Vana is considered to be Lakshmi. Lakshmi means the Vana will give you prosperity. A sacred grove can range from a few trees to several hundred trees in a cluster. Traditionally, a village was sited around a sacred grove and its deity, providing worship and resource extraction to the residents. We call them Banadevi, Gramadevi, Banadurga. They all protect our forests. They also protect the villages. As a tourist, you need to have a good guide to learn about the temple. Because if you see a statue, you cannot have understanding what all this statue is for. So knowledge and information is encoded in the minute details. With the detailed knowledge about the temple hardware, the software of mantra gives the manifestation of different forms of energy. So there should be an online authenticated sources of information and details about all these temples, which may be in a priced document for tourists to buy. I have collected some of the things from the Twitter, and I have summarized some of the informations. For example, you can say Baraha Murthy, Nrisingha Murthy, and all this statue has lots of information hidden in that. For example, if you see the Baraha statue, he is holding the globe on his teeth. Globe means Bhogolo, and it is round, it is sphere. So we know that Earth was a sphere long before these European peoples know it. Similarly, now let us come to the Utsav, that is the festival. We have Ananda Utsav, we have Ananda Bazar, we have Ratha Jatra. In a competitive world, every activity is seen as a war, surrounded by enemies. But the festivals are to be celebrated with friends, dropping the ego. It is the festival for survival and happiness for all. Sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu ma kaschid dukkha bhavat. We are not fighting with anybody. We are all pulling the chariot with devotion. Our creator, the God himself, is surrendering before us, before our devotion, so that the created creatures, the devotees, can pull him, and he is surrendering to the devotees. In different seasons and different days, different gods and goddesses are worshipped in special festivals. Each Sankranti, each Purnami, each Amavasya are celebrated as festivals in Odisha and also in India. Time calendar is maintained in temples, guiding the people of villages. So the temples are the timekeepers in the villages and also in the cities. Through these festivals, we worship water, earth, fire, akash, air as the god. For example, in Holi, we worship Holika, Holika Dahan. Life is full of colors. Festivals manifest like a glass prism. So next I will go to a cultural part of it. What is cultural part of it? Because we are a culture where is agriculture is predominant. If we go to the ice country, the life is harsh in winter. They hope for sunny days and warm. If you go to a desert country, it is full of sand. There is no water. Life is harsh. Camel moving population. But if you come to India, it is a green country. It has rice fields, dense forests, free-flowing rivers, six seasons. You don't feel the need of migration since life is in abundance. So the natural environment of each local area gives its own culture. The timetable of farming is embedded in our Hindu festivals, celebrating the cultivation day, smooth growth, harvesting the grains, the fruits, and related food items produced in the abundance are consumed in these festivals. Rice is one of our greatest technology, rice and wheat, which have changed the face of the planet. The migrant hunters who were going up to the rabbits to kill them, and the killing was called stealing. It has changed, and we have made farmers. And the farmers are not only these farmers. We have Balarama is a farmer. Our Sri Krishna is a farmer. The cows giving milk have become the second mother, and we have Godhana, Gopala, Govinda, all surrounded by cows. Then next is we'll come to some of the things like Sankranti. We are not like haphazard calendar. Our calendar is systematic, and all these are maintained by our temples. We have Mesa Sankranti, Prusa Sankranti, Mithuna Sankranti, Karkata Sankranti, and all these. And in all these Sankrantis, we will have a festival in the temples. The temple will say, okay, this is this Sankranti. And similarly, the Purnami. We have Vaisakha Purnami, Jyeshtha Purnami, Bhadra Purnami, and all this Purnami, there is a festival in the temples. Each festival is coinciding with a specific season. In a specific season, we celebrate the festival in a specific way. And it gives the maximum amount of pleasure to the people. For example, when there is mango fruits, we celebrate with the mangoes. When there is some other type of the full moon night in Kartika Purnami, we worship the moon. So our culture is an worshipping culture. Our culture, not only worshipping culture, it is a culture also of science and technology. The priest asks for the gotra before the worship. What is a gotra? Gotras are like DNA connected to the rishis. We all are connected to some rishis through our gotra. We are the branches of the big knowledge tree. We have to connect with our roots. Panini grammar is an excellent grammar. Entire artificial intelligence is also linked with Panini grammar. And now let us come to these planets. We have Navagraha Murtis in temples and Navagraha Stotram for thousands and thousands of years. And these people have invented, I think, planets some 500 years back. So all these things, when you see, some people will see the beauty. They will just enjoy the beautiful statues as a tourist. But you can also extract the science from it, knowing about the astrology, about the astronomy. You can also know the technology, the application of mantra, jantra, and tantra. For example, if some planet is at a certain location, you may be at a travel because they are all having attractive forces on the earth. So we are a small molecule residing on the earth. And you see the Navagraha mantra, they are so structured. If you see the Navagraha mantra, Om Shangno Mitra Varunaha, and all these mantras are written in our Upanishad. These are the references to Upanishad, Veda, so where all these Navagraha mantras, etc. are written. So there are so many temples. And all these temples have same purposes. No, they have different purposes. Their purposes can be different. Ganesha, knowledge, facts, poems, theories. Krishna, Rasalila, Sangar, dance, defense, makar. Sri Krishna, education, governance. Then you can go to Shiva with the meditation, yogi, adi yogi. Then you go to Kali or you go to Durga. He is a defense minister again, physical, mental, health, yoga, Ayurveda. If you go to Saraswati, Bani, Bina, music, software, and Lakshmi, Ganga, Lalita, Durga, Saraswati, Shakti, wealth, prosperity, happiness. All these things are linked both in economy and also in culture. So let us call to now the Sanskrit mantras. The Sanskrit mantras which are recited in our temples, they are also scientific. For example, if you recite the Lalita Sahasranama, if you understand the Lalita Sahasranama step by step, you will learn a lot of science from that Sahasranama. It will describe the energy centers, different chakras, from Muladhara Chakra, Swadhisthana Chakra, Visuddhi Chakra. All these things are written in this Lalita Sahasranama. It is not just a shloka. It is a scientific theorem. The Hindu temple worships with Sanskrit mantras. We have sankalpa, we have gratitude, we have summarized information as a garland of words. Each word of the mantra has its reference in the statues of the temples. We have Saraswati Ashtakam, Saraswati Shloka, we have Chandi Patha, we have Durga Ashtakam, Navaratri Puja, 108 names of Shiva, Nirvana Satakam, Sivatanda Stotram, we have Kanakadhara Stotram, Rudrashtakam, we have resources, actions, operations, thinking, new and mentoring, creation, startup. All these things are innovation, everything are encoded in a symbolic and cryptic manner in our culture and economy. Now let us have deep understanding about the temples. Who built them? When? There are so many temples, there are so many kings in India who has built with a different structures, with a different architecture. And I cannot have time to read all those names. Temples were the cultural, economical, social, ecological, political, educational, and spiritual center in the past. That is why you see so many temples, not so many palaces. And these temples were all constructed scientifically. They are constructed scientifically for making the arrangements for blissful experiences life. As you know, in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, Idam sairam kanteya khetram iti vidayate. This body is a temple. The human body is a temple for the indwelling spirit of God. Various parts of the temple structure correspond to various parts of the human body also. The temple is a physical body, sthula sarira, which houses the presence of divine. The temple as a human body. Human body is a temple. And there are five layers or seeds, that is called kosha, around the human soul. Hearing these five important for health and happiness, the pancha kosha and temples are related to each other. Annamaya kosha, that is the food seed, it is connected to the outer wall of the temple. Pranamaya kosha, the mind seed, is from the inner parikrama of the temple. Manomaya kosha, the mind seed, it is the inner wall, the vilakakundam. Then Vijnanamaya kosha, the intellect seed, the inner parikrama. And the Anandamaya kosha, that is the bliss seed, that is the garbhagruha. So, and all these things are also linked with our languages. All Indian languages are connected. That is what I have said in Sanskrit operating system for Indian language. All Indian languages are collected and they are similar. Similarities of all Indian languages, they are also connected to chakras. The Varnamala, the garland of letters are connected to different chakras, different energy centers. Indian languages are the greatest components of India's culture. Indian languages are deeply connected to the temples. So if we save our temples, we can save the Indian cultures and Indian languages. This slide is a little bit complicated. So I will not go deep to this slide. Then this is also another slide. As you see, the Muladhara Chakra, then we have Swadhisthana Chakra, we have Visuddhi Chakra, we have Visuddhi Chakra, then we have Ajna Chakra. So all the chakras are also related with some of the things. For example, Muladhara Chakra is linked with four things: psycho-spiritual longing, psychic longing, physical longing, spiritual longing, that we consider dharma, artha, kama, moksha. There are similarly different characteristics, propensities linked with different chakras. And all these things, now let us come to the Shiva, the Adiyogi. Adiyogi, Shiva Mandir, Adiyogi here is to liberate you from disease, discomfort and poverty. Bhagavan from the very process of life and death. It is the message from Sadhguru. There are 12 Jyotirlinga temples. However, there are million temples spread across India. They are all connected to Yogeshwara, Sri Krishna, Adiyogi, Maheshwara. Temples are the center of Yoga and Ayurveda can rejuvenate the health economy. Next, we will go to Saktipitha. Saktipitha is the ferocious weapons in the hands of gods and goddesses to protect. But it is not that someone else will protect it. It is we who have to become ferocious when need arises to protect ourselves from the exploitation. And the next point is, are we linked with only culture or we will also consider economy? Our life is for a very short period of time. Our temples and traditions are for a long time. The vision of blissful and happy life can be achieved if we share the work voluntarily through proper divisions. When we collaborate, we try to connect with each other. When we collaborate, connectivity leads to collaboration. But when we get disconnected, when we fight with each other. The most efficient company has clear demarcation of roles and responsibility. HR, systems, marketing, legal, sales, production, like this. Similarly, in our things, we have, as you know, we have Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. I think that has also been misunderstood. Brahmana is to remove poverty. Kshatriya is to remove fear. And Vaishya is to remove poverty. And Brahmana is to remove ignorance. And Shudra, Rudra, to remove illness. The Hindu Varnashrama Dharma is a science developed by a stable society. It is a system where responsibility is encouraged, where you take the responsibility for life and others' life. in the society was based on specialization. Let us come to the temple as the aggregation point and convention center for traditional professions and traditional economy. I have taken some of the pictures of the recent Rasa Jatra that has been held in Puri Jagannath Mandir. You can see the traditions like carpenter, blacksmith, like all people come together and they have made a beautiful chariot. The tradition guides the economic decisions, the production and distribution. The carpenter depends on woods and the blacksmith on minerals. Every year, festivals are the testing time for the traditional professions. They have the responsibility to protect, force the knowledge and traditions. The family play a major role in traditional profession, educating, guiding, and teaching skills of profession. Traditional professions are guided by traditions passed from one generation to the next generation for centuries, providing sustainability and stability at local areas. The traditional professions try to make all basic necessities fulfilled at the local level, but there was some disconnect. We have been disconnected. So we have to connect with each other. We have to understand the importance of connecting, the connecting all the temples of different groups through our Indian knowledge system. And the Hindu temple development plan, I consider that should be considered four effective plans. That is Ayurveda and disease-free life, defense, that is protecting from enemy, agriculture, trade, business, then education and skill development. As you can see, I am just taking one simple aspect of a culture, that is a marriage. Hindu marriage ceremonies are connected in the temples, starting from horoscope and matchmaking. All these things written in English is the Sanskrit mantras and its meaning that has been written here. In marriage, we worship prayer to Saraswati, prayer to Sun God, and so many things we worship and we take the sankalpa. Many people know it is in Sanskrit. But if you consider consider all these things, you will consider how marriage was constructing a society in so. So we have all the database, we have all the online booking, we can have marriage mandaps in the mandiras, we can have dharmasala, atithisala, and stay arrangements so that Hindus and other people can, Hindus can at least make their marriage smoothly in all those temples. And it will benefit the economy. Similarly, as you know, I am considered a Akshardham temple where the economy things are taken into designing the divine ponds, designing the Natya Mandapa, we can have Narendra Pokhari, Chandana Pokhari, Mandira Pokhari, we can have Ananda Bajara, we can have divine Vrindavana, Srivana, Nandana Kanana, we can have Natya Mandapa, Mukti Mandapa, divine theatres, we can have Hindu Sanskriti Darsana, Kalakunja, Statue Parks, and Dharmasala and online booking, we can also have Wi-Fi hotspots. So art is a reflection of thoughts and a state of mind. A peaceful art makes the mind peaceful. Alternatively, a blissful mind can create a peaceful and blissful art. We can recreate the new heritage replica thanks to the artists who had recreated the great heritage temples through art. I have collected this from Twitter from some of the important persons. There are broken statues from destroyed temples. They are in the museum. The tourists may also want to see the unbroken statues. So the broken statues are museum, but we can have an unbroken statue. It can be museum, the Hindu temple development plan. Many old Hindu temple sites lie in ruins and are kept like a crime scene, not to be tossed, not to be repaired, not to be renewed, not to be developed. We need to renew, we need to repair them. And here is a perception pollution. We have something called Bhutanath, one movie where Amitabh Bachchan is acting as a Bhutanath. But do you know who is Bhutanath? Bhutanath is our Lord Shiva. May we hear the auspicious words with our ears. May we see the auspicious thing with eyes. Tamashoma Jyotirgaya. The Bhutanath group of temples is a cluster of sandstone shrines dedicated to deity Bhutanath in Badami town of Karnataka. Here is the Bhutanath temple of Rishikesh. Here is the Bhutanath temple of Goa. Here is the Bhutanath temple in Mandi. There are thousands and thousands of Bhutanath temple in India, but one movie can entirely pollute our perception. The Bhutanath is someone who is wearing a coat and tie. Similarly, this is one of the important slides. We have to protect the Indian culture and economy. If we are get disconnected, then we cannot see survive. If we are connected, then our goal is survival and happiness for all. Share and win-win. We want to spread light. We are not into in the darkness. We want to construct, not destroy.
we want to have self knowledge and self realization. We want isolation of individual. We don't want isolation of individual. We want aggregation of traditional professions, all professions. We want excellence with voluntary collaborations. All these things, connectivity, unity, aggregation, and technological upgradation of traditional profession can defeat the foreign competition. Our principle is survival and happiness for all. And temples are the protection field for small and wide. Dhanyavaad, namaskar.
Thank you, Maina, for a very comprehensive deliberation. Your presentation was fully packed with loads of information. As I had requested earlier, kindly share your comments and questions in the chat box. Alternatively, you can click on a raise hands emoji, and Asha Narayanji would facilitate you in your satiating your queries. May I now request Asha Narayanji to coordinate the Q&A session.
Yes, sir. Siddharthji. There is one question for first speaker by Mr. Raghunath Inamdar. Can you please elaborate about license and tax breakups in EU as compared to Indian system?
License?
Any kind of license which is required in business and tax breakup?
Yeah. Oh, it's a very complicated topic. I can send him notes on it. He has put a very, very important question. But when he, that is one of the other main reasons why you need to have a partner to address these issues. But when it comes to licensing, as I told you earlier, and I hope I'm answering his questions, the testing, for example, if you're making some food product, you have to disclose, which is the case even in India, you have to disclose all the ingredients that goes into the food making, and then the combined ingredient, what it gives as carbohydrates, what it gives as protein, what it gives as salt, etc., etc. So there are regulations for almost everything. Only thing is that most of it is not stringent. For example, if you want to import food items, you have to disclose the ingredients, you have to make sure that it's organic. If there is any animal content, then the regulation becomes immediately strict. But if you say it's all organic matters or natural matters, the regulations are very, very lenient. So it's a huge topic. I have a book on my shelf for taxation and all. It's this thick a book for every. As I said, even the legal entities, there are 33 different ways you have to set up companies depending on what is the final purpose. The clearances are different. For example, if it is a defense product, if a defense sensitive product, or if you're having a collaboration with somebody where you are exporting something which they want to make sure that whatever you export from here is not going to some third world country where it could be misused or exploited. So my strong suggestion is that is why if you have a very simple item you want to import here, tie up or just even approach some companies straight away. You have to make a trip, talk to them, invite them to your place. Let them see your facilities, let them see how you're manufacturing. What is important for them is who are the people who are behind your projects. That is very important for them. They want the satisfaction of the quality and the caliber of the people who will be responsible for doing the work for them. It's a very complex issue.
Yes, sir. I can understand. Basically, there are very few questions, but I myself coming from Chamber of Commerce Surat, so I've got a question is that you mentioned that we can approach the embassies, various embassies. We have seen lot many embassies are coming to our chamber, but they are generally addressing the issues like that you come to our country, establish the business. That is the main issue we have been, like, every time, even from US or Canada or any other country, we have seen that they are just inviting the investment into their country. So we are not getting much benefit. So how to approach the embassy to have the benefit, manufacturing in India and exporting from India?
Yeah. What I would do is, first of all, of course, I know a lot about some of the European companies who are already operating in India. Most important thing is get the list of those companies who are already in India and see if you could be a source of supply, a subcontractor to some of the things they are buying locally, because a lot of these companies are ultimately exporting it to Europe. That is one of the reasons, that is one of the ways the embassies can help you. Second, the embassies do come to know, for example, if a German company wants to source something from India, they do, either they try to, nowadays, of course, Google has made things much easier, but they still go to the, they will still approach the embassy because they want to make sure that the credentials of the people with whom they do business is legitimate, or there are, because, you know, I'm sorry to say, when the COVID situation was bad and in the month of March of last year, and it was so, I was so angry because there was some Indian party, I don't want to name the party, they had got an order of masks. And they, of course, they sent a sample, which was a correct mask. But then the final product, which was sent to a Singapore party, they had sent envelopes as masks and exported. So the embassy comes into the play mostly to make sure that the credibility of the party they are dealing with is legitimate. It's a legitimate company. The people behind it are legitimate, etc. But when some foreigner is, when they want to go to India to source something, they do take the help of embassies. So embassy help is for that purpose. And of course, when they are proactively approaching you, like you mentioned about the Surat Chamber of Commerce, they have their own agenda to have investments in their country. So that is why they make the trip. But there are different departments. You need to approach the right department.
Thank you, sir. There is one question for the second speaker. How can the Hindu minorities in Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Malaysia use temples for their survival as Hindus?
I have already replied this. There are three, four subjects. One is, we are not Kashmiri Pandits, we are Hindus. We are not Jadavs, we are Hindus. We are not, Ramakrishna Mission, we are Hindus. So when we speak in that language, nobody will harm us. Because unity is strength. I have shown that picture. If we are not united, we are uprooted trees, and the uprooted trees dies. And if we can connect, the connectivity requires collaboration. If we collaborate with among ourselves, then nobody can defeat us. Number two, the competition is only with the enemy. Competition is not among ourselves. Competition is not between Brahmana and Kshatriya. Competition is not between Kshatriya and Sudra. And Sudra is not Dalita. Sudra is the main Rudra. Sudra is the epitome of health. They are the sanitation worker. They are not sanitation worker. They will keep you healthy. And all these types of things will keep us united. If the Hindus are united, no force in the world, because all Hindus are rich in America, then why they are not supporting? They should also support the poor Hindus in India or in Pakistan or in Bangladesh. They are all Hindus. They are not Gujaratis. They are not Odias. They are not West Bengalis or not Bengalis. We should consider ourselves as Hindus. And only then the Hindu unity can survive. And we will be surviving the competition from outside. For inside, there is collaboration. Outside, there is competition. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Raghunath is once again asking to the first speaker, is that Alstom Vadodara, that is just a That is not a question, I think. That he just is just mentioning that Alstom Vadodara factory has been sold to Schneider.
I can explain to him what happened. Basically, there's a lot of consolidation going on. Alstom sold the power division as well as transmission and distribution business to GE. So when they sold the transmission and distribution, the distribution business GE took, sorry, the transmission business GE took, the distribution business was taken by Schneider. So then the factories and all had to be split and sold. And it's amazing. And I'll make this one very short thing, which people should be aware that the consolidation that goes on in Europe is phenomenal. For example, originally, Asia and Brown Boveri formed Asia Brown Boveri. Then meanwhile, GEC, a British company, and Alcatel, a French company, formed GEC Alstom, which became Alstom. Then Alstom bought power division and transmission and distribution division of ABB, Asia Brown Boveri, as a part of Alstom. And now that whole power division, which became united in under one umbrella, the power has been sold to GE, the transmission has been sold to GE, and the distribution has been sold to Schneider. The consolidation is phenomenal. To give an example, Alstom in 1988 was only $2.5 billion size. By 2002, it had become $27 billion. So consolidation becomes a need when an industry or a country reaches a saturation point, and we are nowhere near that point yet. So when they reach a saturation level, there is no more power plants to build in Europe. So obviously consolidation takes place. Same thing is happening with water treatment and waste disposal. You have Suez and Veolia, which is merging. They are huge giants. I mean, these are huge companies with very, very strong balance sheets. And yet they have to merge because that's the only way to survive.
Thank you, sir. Sir, once again, one question for you is that for pharma sector, US FDA is easier than EU policies.
Very good point. To give you an idea, anything in EU is far more stringent requirement than United States. But then when you come to Japan is even far more stringent than European Union. It depends on the country. But one thing is that once you meet the standard, that is their advantage and disadvantage. The disadvantage is the approval process takes time. You have to go through the test and all. But the advantage is you don't have competition. Once you get the approval, it's a fantastic place to work with, do business. But the main key thing is meet the requirements locally. Their European Union standards for quality, for safety is far, far more stringent than in United States. To give an idea, in France, for example, has in manufacturing, they have the lowest accident rate in the world. Not America, not Japan even, not Korea or other, even not even Germany. France has the lowest accidental death rate in the world, mainly because in United States, if there is an accident and somebody kills and somebody's dead, the family of that person has to prove that the company was negligent and that's why he died or got injured. In France, if somebody is injured or dead on the shop floor, the management of the company, including the managing director, has to prove that he was not negligent. So he can be jailed. If somebody is injured or killed in France in a factory, the managing director, even if he's not at fault, he could end up in jail if he doesn't have a good explanation. My company, which was making Queen Mary 2, we finished that ship 2 weeks in advance. And what the company did is to celebrate the completion of the ship, they threw a party where all the employees, the workers with the families could come and see the ship before it starts sailing. and before it was even commissioned. And I don't know if you remember the what happened is the, you know, the ship on the dry dock is like 8-story high, and the ramp connecting the ship and the dry dock, the mainland, it collapsed, and 8 people died on the spot. Immediately, the managing, the CEO of my company, who was vacationing in Greece, he got a call. He did not even go to his hotel room. He took the same flight, first flight available, in his short pants, in his shirt, which was, he was on the beach, but he had, of course, he was always carrying his passport and wallet. And he went straight to the site to show that he was concerned about what has happened. He had to do it. If he did not do that, he could end up in jail. So the European Union has very strict rules for imports, for quality of the product, safety of the product, durability of the product. They want to make sure that whatever parts you're importing, they meet certain standards. They want to make sure even the factory where you're making these things in India meet certain minimum standards. But once you go through that, you know that you are making a world-class product for sure.
Yes, but the same rules are available in India also. But yes. Managing directors or authorities getting escaping. They are having many loopholes, so they are escaping. Thanks for explaining this.
Yeah.
One more last question is there from my side. Generic and composite medicines is not allowed in EU. What is the reason? Can you tell me?
See, for the same safety reason, but now there is a big debate going on. They have started allowing generic also. They're very, 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 very good question. This has been debated for a very long time. And in fact, now, after some massive debate, just to give an example, I live right opposite a pharmacy. By the way, in Paris and in France, every block has a pharmacy and a bakery. Because they want to make sure that old people don't have to walk too far to get the medicine. So anyway, I had some very severe allergy problem by which the doctor gave a prescription medicine. I went to my store and the prescription medicine was not available. It was out of stock, unusual, you know. But the pharmacy by law had to tell me that we do have a generic product, but mm-hmm. made by so-and-so company. The pharmacist was educated to, she went to the extent of explaining who manufactured that product. It is a generic product. It is a much lower price, but we are letting you know that it is not a branded product, but it is safe. After she gave her explanation and I agreed that, yeah, I agree with you, she gave me the generic product. So now they have started even selling the generic product. Originally, the big pharma companies had big controls over everything, but these things are changing in Europe now.
Now, might be possibly north and central or west Paris, not in south Paris, I think. Southern part of Paris is very difficult.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Yes, it's neither. I'm sorry. I didn't understand the question. Sorry, can you?
No, it's not a question. You are in. Okay. You might be in the northern Paris, or western Paris. No, it will be difficult in the southern Paris part.
You know, France is a, you know, just like in India. Depending on which part of France you go, it's a different country again. The southerners are a little laid back, easygoing, relaxed, having their soup and siesta, etc. They're very Latin culture. While if you go to the east, which is bordering Germany, very tough people, very hardworking, very industrious. If you go to north, which faces the United Kingdom, again, and then you go to west, and you know, France was always a major naval power. So if you go to north and west, there are ports and there are navy establishments, very, very technical, very outgoing people. So it's a different place, different country at different places. Like Brittany, which was originally partly British territory. There are parts of France which was before a Spanish territory. There are parts of France in the east which was German territory. So again, again, it's a hodgepodge, but one thing is there, like India, we are very proud of being Indians. Even though I've lived abroad, I'm still very proud of it. And even in India, just like we are different parts of the country, but we are so, you know, like look at this celebration across the country of this javelin throw. I've got like 50 SMSs which has come, and these are people from different castes, different communities, different regions, different languages, enjoying. Same thing in France, they're always, they really identify themselves as French and European Union. Now, one thing that is happening, as you must have seen, you could never have imagined 50, 100 years ago that Germany and France are allies against everybody, you know. And to one major change that is happening is that after Trump, who decided to, you know, threaten to leave NATO, etc., automatically, France is the only country which makes all the defense items. They make ships, they make aircraft, they make tanks, they make armor vehicles. They're very good in electronic warfare. So now France is playing a major role for defense, internally and externally in Europe. They have taken kind of a, by default, leadership role because they are the only ones who make all the items for defense. And on a different topic, I'm very happy that India is buying Dassault because Rafael planes, because even my friends in the United States who are in the Air Force, they are telling me that Dassault is 10 years ahead of any advanced fighter jet made in the world. So I think I feel very secure with that.
The last part was very interesting and very, it makes proud to every Indian.
Yeah.
Sir, just last question from my side is that you mentioned about quality, in-time production, consistency, transparency. These are all very, very important factors. But as per you, where do you rate Indian production in industry at present and after 10 years?
10 years before or 10 years from now?
From now.
I am very optimistic. We all have to be optimistic for India's future. And I'm very happy to, when I talk to younger generation, what is surprising is that 70% of Indian population is below 25 years, and yet 70% of them are optimistic of the future. We have no choice but to be quality. We have to improve our quality. I mean, the very fact that we could send satellites and do surveillance from space, you can't have more quality issue address than space products. So if we can send satellites to space, we can do anything in the world. So I'm very optimistic. We have to understand that if we want to get into manufacturing of planes, battle tanks, ships, the failure is not an option. You can't have a component, even a one component failing can destroy the whole defense establishment. So quality is a must. There is no compromise. You can't have a shortcut on quality. It is like, you know, that song, for the sake of the shoe, horseshoe, the battle was lost. The same thing. It is not just making a component or chalta hai quality. You know, we can't be slack in quality. Chalta hai re ye kya hai, usme koi dekhega nahi. People don't realize that if a product, when the standards are laid down of quality, it is for specific reason. When the alloy is used, it's a specific reason. When there are certain tolerances required, it is for specific reason. There is no compromise. We have to make sure that we focus on quality. If you want to progress as a nation, quality, delivery on time, consistency, is very, very, very important.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So I hand over
to one. I would like to say something about the second presentation. Subrat Kumar ji, this was so amazing. It was such an eye-opener. Your presentation, and I really, really enjoyed. There was so much knowledge in it. And I'm better late than never, I hope. Many years ago, heading Alstom, I was based in Chennai for 4 years and then 2 years in Delhi. I used to travel and visit a lot of this historical in old places, temples, including, of course, Konark Temple is one of my favorite in Orissa, the Sun Temple. is very important. It's amazing the what you see. At that time, it was very difficult for me to find a book about all the temples. And one of my South Indian friends showed me one small book somebody had written ages ago with hardly very poor quality paper. I think what is really required is that we need to professionally prepare a good book. We should make sure that it is written properly. I have some report which I had prepared long time ago. If India just focused on that and tourism, we can solve our what you call balance of payment problems. It will be amazing the tourism attraction that would be there if we could educate, and once this infrastructure is done and if we have good hotels. I mean, it's sad that Singapore has more tourists than whole of the country of India. Imagine how many tourists we can come. That can solve the problem of India's currency. If rupee would appreciate like mad if we do that. So please focus on see how we can make, first of all, good presentation, like you did a very good presentation. But now we need to prepare books where all the knowledge are in one place. There is no one place where I can find knowledge of all the temples about India. We don't have it. And there are so many beautiful temples.
Thank you very much, sir. Actually, my objective was to make a mobile application where the 1 million temples should be there, and all the websites, like we have 6.5 lakh villages, we should have a temple database in the entire country. Exactly. Each village has access to a temple. One Shiva Mandir, one Panadurga Mandir, one Shakti Mandir, at least. Then we have Jagannath Mandir, Sri Ram Mandir, or Sri Krishna Mandir. So if we have a database of all the temples around the India, then to the world, I think we can connect, because now broadband is available in villages. So we can have Wi-Fi hotspots in the nearer to temples, and the people can use the Wi-Fi, and they can stay there, they can work from there. Because we have migrated to outside does not mean that we are uprooted. We are also rooted. We should connect and strengthen our root. And if we can connect and strengthen our root, then the things will develop in our own, we will know more about our temples. If we know more about temples, we will tell more to the tourists. So the tourists, more tourists will come. For example, I have given one slide, the tourist slide. It is so complicated. I mean, so many things are there. If you go to the Modera temple of Gujarat, the guide has told me a story which is so important. So many things he has told. It has all been lost because that it is full of gold and diamonds. They have all been stolen. All the temples are full of gold and diamonds. That is the reason they have been broken, they have been ruined, they have been stolen. Now we have to again rejuvenate that. Sir has told something about Angkor Wat. What is Angkor Wat? Angkor Wat is our Indian people who has gone to Cambodia. Cambodia is what? Cambodia, Odia. Odia means Odisha, Odia. In Cambos, in Tamil Nadu. So Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Trikalinga. Trikalinga is Trilinga. Trikalinga means Telugu. Kalinga, Trikalinga. Trikalinga is Telugu. The Telugu, Odia, Tamil, all this eastern side, they have gone to that side. And they have made the temples in Bali, Java, Sumatra, and we have a Bali Jatra in Odisha. What is Bali Jatra? It is not the sand journey. It is a Jatra to the Bali, that island of Bali. We have a lot of trades. Okay, there are some disturbances, there are some earthquakes, there are some floods, there are some cyclones. That is the Angkor Wat could not be connected. It was full of forest. But now that we have eyes, we have connectivity, we have the all the powers, we can connect and strengthen the root, and this can be possible if we all connect together, irrespective of language, irrespective of the religion, irrespective of the caste. We have to protect our culture. We have to protect our Hinduism. If Hinduism lives, then Hindustan will live. That is also my philosophy. This is a personal opinion. This is my opinion of my explanation.
One thing you may want to add. Is that traditionally almost every Indian home also is a temple. You'll have some corner of the house where you'll put a, you know, some idols, some pictures and worship. And I've seen that even that continuing even in America. I've been to so many Indian homes where they still have their own temple inside their homes.
Okay.
So that makes it very special.
Individual is isolated.
Yeah.
When we make temples in our house. Correct. Only if we will connect, we will build temples. If we don't connect, we will be isolationist. We will be individually, we will have our own temple in our house. But we need aggregation. Only the aggregation can build temples like Chidambaram, like Padmanabhi Swami temple, like the temple Jagannath temple, like Konark temple. This can only happen if you go and contribute our thing to the nation or to the aggregation. If we build a small temple in house, that may be very costly, but that will not add to the temples like Padmanabhi Swami temple or Chidambaram temple. It needs a deep encouragement, deep aggregation. Lot of people has to come together.
Yeah. See, now what is happening is with the internet and with the improvement in computer technology and with the improvement in reducing the compressing numbers and data, I'm sure that we can create a database of all these samples, as well as we can start sorting out in terms of the deities worship in the temple, the location of the temple. And I'm sure when we do some kind of a number crunching, far more information will come out, which is still not known. I think we need to do that. We need to start collecting information.
Sir, we need some structured way of doing things, because in a crowdsourcing mode, it is already done. A lot of people are uploading the YouTube videos in different parts of the country. They are very energetic and enthusiastic. They upload their own local area things. But if we have to go beyond only a few temples, we have to go the million temples. All the million temples have a lot of history. So we have to connect with all the local history. That is why I call a town called Todola, total development of local area. If we don't consider total development of local area, we will not feel development, real development. Because
that was a very good point you brought it up. That was amazing what you brought out. That it's called, it is an economy by itself. That is not yet. This is the first time, and I'm so glad I'm present today. That first time I'm hearing that economics, the link between economics and the temples and nature, very important in today's world. That is very important to know. So thank you for that.
Over to Subrata,
sir. Yeah, thank you, Asha ji.
One last question, Siddharth, sir.
Raghunath ji, after we formally end the program, we'll have enough time, so probably offline, I mean, after the official function is over, we can have a talk, so long as the program is on. So, for the paucity of time, we shall wind up with Dhanyavad Gyapan, Thanksgiving by Tanmay ji. Tanmay ji, after Dhanyavad Gyapan, we'll also chant Shanti Mantra. While he chants Shanti Mantra, please keep your mics on mute. And after the Shanti Mantra gets over, we'll formally end today's webinar. You all are free to interact informally after the end of the Shanti Mantra. Thank you.
Thank you, Siddharthi. Yes, it is a very, very vibrant program, I believe. And it has been covered with the culture, economy, food of Pan-India, I would say Pan-world. It's like an amalgamation of both our culture and also how it has enriched the world economy. I think that is a very important part of the future. And so at the beginning, I would like to convey my heartfelt thanks to Sri K. Moradanji. His vibrant speech enriched us significantly, and he has shown the path how to invest in European market and what would be the benefit for the investors, how they can invest. And I think that is very much informative for young investors, young business people. At the secondly, I would like to convey my gratitude to Sri Subrat Kumar Pusatji. And I believe that his creative and meaningful speech about the Indian culture and its contribution in country's further development is very much important, and I believe that his talk has developed an route how to do the further research on Indian culture, Indian food habit, how it helps in our health. So that is very vibrant speech, I believe. And lastly, we would like to thank our mentor, and I am always humbled and blessed, grateful to our Mananiya Pracharakji Sri Ravi Kumar Ji and his presence in everywhere, in all, either physically or in virtually. It always blessed us, and I am really, really thankful to Mananiya Sri Ravi Kumar Ji. At the end, I would like to thank Siddharth Daveji, our Hindi Genius community, and they do regular meetings, and which I believe that is very much important. Along with our busy schedule, we always come and get together to share with our ideas, share with our views, which might help our individual character, our young generation character. And with that thing, I will end up here, and I'll do the Shanti Mantra, and you can go with us, go with me. So here I am starting the Shanti Mantra. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah. सर्वे शान्तुर्निर्वा सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग्भवे ॐ शान्तिः शान्तिः शांति। With that thing, I can.
Yeah, thank you, G. So with that, we formally conclude today's program. Please feel free to interact and share.
Siddharth Ji, Priyanka, it is already midnight in Singapore. She has joined.